Yesterday, Lieutenant Richard Rudolph, we saw two people put in custody. As much as we're quick to jump and tear down the NYPD when something goes wrong, when something goes great, we got to be equally excited to lift them up because they out here in this cold, keeping communities safe. And listen, this was a two-year investigation. This wasn't light work.
It really was an extensive, basically three-year investigation. And it was with a lot of social media research, follow-up interviews, cell phone data research, and basically link analysis and old-school detective work.
And the fact that they got to two people, the driver and the shooter, and even got the motive.
Well, we believe that back in 2009, Chinks and Quincy Homer, which was one of the persons arrested yesterday, were in Rikers Island together and got into a physical dispute. And they became, it got into kind of a tough fight. And it just festered after that. And then in 2015, they were both at a concert in Miami and at the Soundgarden with Uncle Murda and French Montana. And Quincy became the outcast of the group because they felt that he was running with Chinks. And so it was an ongoing dispute between Chinks and Homer. We believe this Quincy Homer is our shooter, and Jamar Hill was in a participant in it. But we believe there's only one shooter, and that was Quincy.
Lisa Evers.
Hey guys, how you doing?
Well, first of all, how are you doing?
I still have my voice, so I'm considering myself lucky.
Well, the way you were standing next to those dudes as they were walked into the precinct last night, and you was like, why did you kill Chinks? I was like, wait a minute, Lisa, you think they're going to answer that question?
I mean, you never know, Ebro.
She has to dive right in.
Sometimes they do, Ebro, and sometimes they say some pretty incredible things. But I was just lucky to be able to break the story that they made an arrest because I've been following this and working on this case since it first happened and have seen so many ups and downs and twists and turns and so many people on social media and on the streets going, oh, you know, they're never going to solve this. They're never going to get these people. And it was great to see that. And especially for Janelle and for Janelle and Chinks' kids, I felt really
it's
happy
amazing.
Because, you know, she's just handled this whole thing with so much dignity and with so much love. I mean, Chinks was her childhood sweetheart. So, you know, we see him as the artist, but to, you know, to have that family connection, to know that she was involved. The detectives were so cool and so respectful with her all the way through, and I thought that was really pretty amazing.
Well, Lisa, I have a couple questions for you. First, how did you watch, and watching the NYPD and all the detectives pull this kind of these leads together and this whole investigation together, when you talk of twists and turns, what were some of them?
Well, I think the biggest twist and turn, I'm going to put it out there, and I know I'm going to take flack for it, but I got to keep it 100 and tell you exactly what happened. There were a lot of people from day one, as many of us in the community felt, that knew what had happened or knew, had key information that could have helped them solve this, you know, earlier. They did not talk. And they did not talk to the police because we all know the no snitching code and that type of thing. But that was one of the obstacles. The other obstacles was another thing people kept saying to me was, well, you know what, this happened on Queens Boulevard, which was actually on Main Street at Queens Boulevard, which at that time there was construction. It was very dark, and it was in a dark pocket where there were no cameras. So a lot of crimes now are solved with video surveillance that the police have or law enforcement has, and that's how they get people. But there was no video surveillance for that. So that was a problem also. And then, you know, just the nature of this, the way people moved around, the two suspects that are under arrest now were involved in other incidents, other criminal incidents after this. In fact, they're doing time on other things right now. So there were just a lot of, just a lot of roadblocks that they kept hitting.
So, Lisa, we're confident these are the right two individuals.
Yeah, Ebro, and that's an important, that's another question that people have been bringing up, especially on my Instagram, at Lisa Evers. One of the things is, this isn't a case like the cops, this is not like back in the day or what people see in movies. You know, cops are driving around, they see somebody and they go, oh, wow, they fit the description let's bring them in and beat out a confession of them. That is not this at all. This is policing 2017 going into 2018, which their buzzword is precision policing. Let's go after the people that we think really did it. Let's see if there's evidence to prove that, instead of doing these massive roundups that we saw in the past. And, you know, in the bad old days where stop and frisk was out of control. So that they had to present the case, and one of the reasons it took so long, nearly 2.5 years, was they had to present this case to a grand jury in Queens County. That's 21 people. 21 people had to listen to weeks and weeks and weeks of evidence and testimony, and then they had to come to a unanimous verdict, not verdict, but unanimous decision to hand up an indictment, which is exactly what happened. Both these guys got murder, second-degree murder charges, which is the highest that you can get, you know, the highest murder charge a civilian you can get for killing a civilian.
So, Lisa, we just spoke to the lieutenant. I don't know if you heard that conversation, Richard Rudolph.
I did miss that, unfortunately. But
yeah, and
I interviewed him yesterday, obviously.
Yeah, he detailed these two individuals, or at least the one individual, I think the shooter, and Chinks had gotten into a fight when they were both locked up in 2009.
Right.
And that's where this all comes from, because Chinks' career, they get out, Chinks' career starts to take off. The other individual not having as much success and feels like he's being ostracized from the clique, if you will, and not right. able to be around because of the fight that he had with Chinks back in 2009, is the way I understand it.
Yes, that's what I understand too. And it's crazy, but it's also the person you're talking about, suspect number one, is Quincy Homer. And he was known. He had his, you know, he had his social media thing out as Quality, spelled Quality. He was trying to move around in those circles, and he because of that beef with Chinks, he just wasn't he got no respect, he got no recognition. And at the same time, you know, Chinks is putting in work. Chinks is traveling. Chinks is doing shows. He's writing songs. He's up on Hot 97. He's doing all of those things, and. You know, it's seething. That hatred is seething in him, and he became fixated with the success Chinks was having and where his life was absolutely going nowhere. And then in the meantime, too, according to the public records and the court records, he was involved in other crimes. So it wasn't like he was, you know, Chinks had his time on the streets, and according to what the investigators had told me, too, and here was another thing that was out on, you know, people were talking about a lot. Chinks had really turned the corner on the street thing and put that behind him because the music thing was working. He really was on the verge of doing some major mainstream things, as we all know. So that got to this guy even more, you know?
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, Lisa Evers doing that work. Street Soldiers every Sunday right here, Hot 97. Lisa, we love you.
Thanks, Lisa.
Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you so much. And we're going to have a special half-hour Street Soldiers on this a week from tonight. We're going to put together something really great for everybody, detailing point A, point B. And I just want to shout out everybody that's been talking to me behind the scenes about this case from day one. And thank you for all your help. And I was very happy to be able to break the news yesterday because it was something that a lot of people thought would never, ever happen. And shout out to Detective Thomas Scalise. He grew up listening to Hot 97 and
Thomas.
Street Soldiers, understood the culture, and I think that helped him a lot too, you know?
Thank you, Lisa.